Good evening, everyone. Time to get back in God's Word just a few minutes. This time we're going to be reading and talking off the 14th chapter of the great book of Isaiah and see what he tells us concerning Christ Jesus. To me also, this is a great chapter telling us about the coming of Jesus. You don't hear it read much and talk about during Christmas time, but I love to talk about it and read it at Christmas time and any time through the year. Our most kind and gracious Heavenly Father, it's again we come to you, Lord, with a thankful heart to thank you for many blessings. We thank you for another day, and we thank you, Lord, for another time that you have given us to sit down and look into your word just a few minutes. I pray you anoint every listener that they can hear, understand what you're saying. And I pray, Lord, you give me understanding and a knowledge how to explain this scripture to those that hear it, that they may understand. It is your word, it's your prophecy of the coming of our Savior, our Lord Jesus Christ. And I pray you bless each one that listens to this, that you'll fill their heart with mercy and with joy and with love, knowing they are your child. These things we ask in the lovely name, in the wonderful name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and amen. And thank you, Father, for your love and your mercy. Isaiah 14, King James Version Bible. And if you can, read along with me. I'm going to start at verse number 1. And it reads, "For the Lord will have mercy on Jacob, and will yet choose Israel, and set them in their own land. And the strangers shall be joined with them, and they shall cleave to the house of Jacob," or cleave to, or join to, the house of Jacob. "2, and the people shall take them, and bring them to their place, and the house of Israel shall possess them in the land of the Lord for servants and handmaids, and they shall take them captives whose captives they were, and they shall rule over their oppressors." Other words, the one that captured them now is going to be captured by the children of Israel that have already been captured. Said, "And they shall rule over their oppressors." They'll be a ruler over the ones that captured them. The Lord has a way. He knows how to turn the tables on those that don't want him and those that persecute his children. Verse 3, "And it shall come to pass in the day that the Lord shall give thee rest from thy sorrow and from thy fear and from the hard bondage wherein thou wast made to serve." All right, here again. Why does people that have been saved want to go back and be entangled and that old bondage of sin and things that we were set free from? Let's ask ourselves these questions. It would be someone that hasn't been founded upon the rock as it should be. "For that thou shalt take up this proverb against the king of Babylon." See, the king of Babylon, He went in and he captured them. And he didn't treat them right. And therefore, the Lord delivered them. Now it's going to turn to the king of Babylon, that thou shalt take up this proverb against the king of Babylon, and say, how hath the oppressor seized the golden city, seized the city that had everything? How had she became quiet? She became quiet, or she seized from her things that she done by due to the hands of her father, because he returned to them what they done to his children, because they made them to suffer when they wasn't supposed to do that. Verse 5, the Lord hath broken the staff of the wicked and the scepter of the rulers. He has taken their power away from them. He's returned to them the things that they did to God's children. And if they did that then, they would do that to us today. They try to do everything they can to hinder our message from going out, to hinder us, to set us back, and to cause us to fall from the love of the Lord Jesus Christ, and to prevent us from spreading the gospel of the good news. Verse 6, he who smote the people in wrath with a continual stroke, he that ruled the nations in anger, is persecuted and none hindereth. None stopped them. None could stop the hand of the Lord from working on those that had mistreated his people, though they took in to captive. Verse 7, the whole earth is at rest and is quiet. They break forth into singing. Why? Because they had a great deliverance. But one day after a while, we all are going to have a great deliverance if we have been saved by the grace of God. We can't save ourselves. The Lord has to save us. Verse 8. Yea, the fir tree rejoice at thee, and the cedar of Lebanon, saying, since thou art laid down, no power is come up against us. Now he's going on to explain who was behind their persecution, persecution of his children. Now listen to verse 9. And why people, why people would disregard this scripture, I will never know, because I never understand. But listen to what he says. Verse number 9. Hell from beneath is moved for thee to meet thee at thy coming. It stirreth up the dead for thee, even all the chief ones of the earth. It hath raised up from their thrones all the kings of the nations. It's something to look into. My friends, loved ones, those that are saved, we need to look into these things. See really what happened in those days and what's going to come to us in the end of our journey when the Lord says time shall be no longer. 10, and they shall speak and say unto thee, art thou also become weak as we? Art thou become like unto us? In other words, the ones that are already there. It caused them to do bad things to God's children. When these high uplifted men descend into that place, one that there is going to raise up and come against Satan, the one that caused all this by filling man's heart to persecute God's children. Leaven, thy pomp is brought down to the grave, and the noise of the vials, the worms, is spread under thee, and the worms cover thee. His day ended. This king, his day ended. And all those that persecuted God's people, their day had come. And like I said, we can always be sure the day of the Lord will come. Now listen, this identifies the one that caused these people to persecute God's children. And he's still working overtime today in our lives. And we can see it all around us. Wherever we look, wherever we go, his presence is there. And we can see the evil working and taking place. Now you're going, like I said, now he's going to identify who's caused all this. 12. How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground, which did waken the nations? He's telling Satan, Lucifer, you cut down to the ground. You're high up. It's now nothing. You were lifted up in your pride. He tried to take over heaven, but he couldn't. But now he was cast down to the ground, which did weaken the nations. Now listen, here where he is still identified. Lucifer, or we call him Satan. 13. For thou hast said in thine heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. He is the one. He is going to come to this earth before Jesus returns. And he is going to pretend that he is Jesus, our Savior. And he will deceive many, especially those that are not saved and those that have strayed away and think they don't need him anymore. He told them where his seat was. But people won't listen to this and take warning that he will come first before Jesus does, which is he comes under the sixth trump that we find in Revelation. But Jesus comes under the seventh trump that we also find in Revelation. 14, I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. He said he would be like God, because God is the Most High. There are none any higher than God. 15, yet thou shalt be brought down to hell, to the sides of the pit, although you have built yourself up as a great one, you will be brought down to hell. This is not my word. This is God's word that he has spoken over and over. Every time people has read it, it's also spoken to them. No minister or teacher on this earth can read this and say it don't apply to them, because it applies to everyone. Although they think it don't, it will. It does apply to them. And if they don't change, one day they gonna know it did apply to them and they rejected it. 16. They that see thee shall narrowly look upon thee and consider thee, saying, is this the man that made the earth to tremble and did shake kingdoms? They gonna make fun of him. Now that he's in the hell, they're gonna be making fun of him. The devil, Satan, Lucifer, the one that tried to destroy the nations and caused that great persecution of God's children, and what he still calls, the way he still calls his people to suffer today. Seventeen, that made the world as a wilderness, and destroyed the cities thereof, that opened not the house of his prison. He kept them bound and shut up, and wouldn't release them. But God got a way of setting them free, and he will. He set them free then. He will set free today. So let's hold on and hang on to the one that sets us free from this bondage of sin and his hold on us, the saved people. And let us keep pressing on towards home, towards heaven, and be a witness and singing God's praise as we go. 18. All the kings of the nations, even all them, lie in glory, every one in his own house. 19. But thou art cast out of thy grave like an abominable branch. And as the remnant of those that are slain thrust through with a sword that go down to the stones of the pit, a carcass trodden under feet, thou shalt not be joined with them in burial, because thou hast destroyed thy land and slain thy people. The seed of evildoers shall never be renown. They would be done away with forever, that they cannot torment and trouble people anymore. And God's children, the ones that's redeemed, those that are saved, will go home in the morning when he calls them to a land of ever rejoicing, to never suffer pain or death or persecutions again. Now listen, it gets deeper and deeper as we go along. And why people won't take heed to these words, we'll never understand, except they don't have no knowledge of God. They have no fear of God. And many haven't been saved. 21. Prepare slaughter for his children, for the iniquity of their fathers, that they do not rise, nor possess the land, nor fill the face of the world with cities. Those people that come against that holy city, Jerusalem, in the land of Israel, one day are going to be removed from this earth. And they'll never hurt the children of Israel anymore. And when we were born again, we became grafted in to the Lord Jesus Christ, that olive tree, and forever be a part of the spiritual Israel, or the spiritual Jew. "22, for I will rise up against them, saith the Lord of hosts, and cut off from Babylon the name and remnant and son and nephew, saith the Lord." He would cut them all off. And that day is coming, my friends, to this world, to all today, and wants to destroy and persecute God's children. 23, I will also make a possession for the bittern and pools of water, and I will sweep it with the bosom of destruction, saith the Lord of hosts. How can a man, or a woman, be saved by the grace of God and read this and not know we better have and be sure and know and glorify God that we are saved by his grace. And thank him and praise him for his mercy every day that he did love us and that he saved us. Now listen. 24. The Lord of hosts hath sworn, saying, surely as I have thought, so shall it come to pass, and as I have proposed, so shall it stand. God's word standeth sure forever, settled in heaven. Whether man likes it or not, it still stands. And no matter how much they try to change it, and add to and take away from it, and leave out what people need to know most, it will not stand, because God's word will stand forever and ever, and he is the living word to never be changed. And we understand Revelations, where he said, he that added to, he added to the plagues that are written in this book. And if he takes away, he take his part out of the book of life. "25, that I will break the Assyrian in my hand, and upon my mountains tread him underfoot. Then shall his yoke depart from off them." In other words, he will break the yoke, and his children, his people, will go free. And his burden depart from off their shoulders. They won't have to carry those burdens any longer. 26, this is the purpose that is proposed upon the whole earth. And this is the hand that is stretched out upon all the nations. Talking about the Lord's hands is stretched out, inviting on people to come to him. But people will stand in their way. Will not let them press through the crowd, the doubts and unbelief. And he said, and this is the hand that is stretched out upon all the nations. Now listen, 27. For the Lord of hosts hath proposed, and who shall disannul it? God has spoken. And who can disannul it? Who can tear it down? No man can tear down God's word, because it forever will remain. For the Lord of hosts hath proposed, and who shall disannul it? And his hand is stretched out, and who shall turn it back? We can't turn his hand back. Once he lays his hand out, lays his hand down upon anyone, they can't turn his hand back unless they get saved. If they reject him and die in that condition of rejection, they cannot turn back and make things right, because they're gone from this earth forever. 28, in the year that King Ahaz died, was this burden. But now listen what he still goes on to say. 29, rejoice not thou, whole Palestina, because the rod of him that smote thee is broken. For out of the serpent's root shall come forth a cockatrice, and his fruit shall be a fiery flying serpent. And the firstborn of the poor shall feed, and the needy shall lie down in safety. And I will kill the root with famine, and he shall slay thy raiment, those that remain. In other words, he would raise up something that would take care of those that were still left. Now let me read this 29 again. Rejoice not thou, whole Palestina, because the rod of him that smote thee is broken. For out of the serpent's root shall come forth a cockatrice, and his fruit shall be a fiery flying serpent. And the firstborn of the poor shall feed, and the needy shall lie down in safety. And I, famine, and he shall slay thy raiment. How, O gate, cry, O city, thou whole Palestina, art this dissolved? For there shall come from the north a smoke, and none shall be alone in his appointed times. 32, what shall one then answer the messenger of the nation, that the Lord hath found Zion, and the poor of his people shall trust in it? That holy city, Mount Zion, a people, the place that Jesus loves. That's where we, those that redeemed, will live with him someday. Now, the ones that crucified our Lord and Savior, beat him and persecuted him, even some of them, they will face what he's talking about right here. Then they're going to all know that they crucified our Lord and Savior. They crucified the very one that could have saved them and gave them life eternal. But this, my friends, is speaking to every one of us today. And the Satan, Lucifer spirit was behind the killing of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. When the Roman soldiers nailed him to that tree, that old rugged cross. But it would never happen again. He died once and for all, to never have to die and go through that anymore. That's why it's also necessary and should be read during the Christmas season, because of great mercy that the Lord had on us to save us and redeem us and lead us out of the bondage of sin and corruption that destroys both body and soul. Our most kind and gracious Heavenly Father, again we give you praise, we give you the honor, and we give you the glory that you let us sit one more time to get into your word. Lord, I thank you, Lord, for every word you've given me. And I pray, oh Lord, you help each one of us to see what you telling us, that how great it is for us to be saved and to know that you are our Redeemer and there is no other. And I pray, Lord, for those today that lost and don't know you as their Savior, Lord, I pray they'll come to you and be saved, for it's everlasting too late. But Lord, some say it's never too late. But yes, it is, Lord. If they die without you, then it's too late. They can't go back and do things over. And Lord, I pray for those that's sick and afflicted in body. You reach down, heal, deliver, and touch, and set free. If it's your will, Lord, I pray you will heal everyone. And we know you are a great healer. But if it's not your will for them to be healed in this life, I pray, Lord, you make their pain and suffering easier to bear. Then, Lord, one day when you call us home, we can kneel at your feet and bow our head and give you the praise and honor and glory that we know not how to give today. For cause then, Lord, we'll be with you forever. And, Lord, forevermore we can give you the praise. These things we ask in the wonderful name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. And I thank you one more time, dear Father, for your love and your mercy.